the 8th AOI Basic to Advanced Lecture Series. And we have on the platform 4 eminent people. Srinivas, who is my friend, who is the moderator of the first session. And Dr. Srinivas has done his master's in otorhinolaryngology, and has done in fellowship in otology from Paris. And his main interest is in otology. And he has got many publications, national as well as international, and is invited speaker in national as well as regional conferences. And he has occupied many positions and various academic positions in our national body, as well as state AY and South Zone AY. And he's also one of the editorial member of our prestigious journal. I welcome Dr. Srinivas to start the session, today's session. Dr. C.V. Srinivas, over to you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for your kind words. They are not relevant to our presentation today, but good that you had some kind words to say about me. It's a privilege to occupy this moderator chair today to moderate the session on the AY web series on the educational part of commitment from the AY. And it gives me immense pleasure to introduce today's prestigious speaker, Dr. Ramandeep Work. Sir, very good evening to you.
Evening.
It's my pleasure to, you know, give this introduction. Sir is now professor in the Department of ENT at PGI Chandigarh. And he did his graduation and post-graduation from DMC Ludhiana, and senior residency from Government Medical College Chandigarh. And after which he worked in London at the Northwick Park and Central Middlesex Hospitals. Currently he's working as professor in the Department of ENT at PGI Chandigarh, which is a premier tertiary referral center of the nation. He joined PGI in 2006 and very extensively, actively involved in research work. He has numerous publications in the national and international journals and has undertaken various research projects. He has been an invited faculty as a surgeon, speaker, and panelist to various conferences within the country and abroad. Areas of interest include endoscopic skull-based surgery, endoscopic sinus surgery, stepidotomy with CO2 laser, and coablation in airway diseases. Extensive work done in treatment of allergic fungal rhinosinusitis, fungal lesions of the sinonasal region, and also use of coablation in the sinuses for JNA, pituitary surgeries, and CSF leaks. That forms a fantastic gamut of field for Dr. Ramandeep work. And positions held, he has been an associate editor of JIPMA, Journal of Postgraduate Medical Education and Research, which is the official journal of PGI. He's a member of the coveted otosclerosis study group, and he is the only one from India. Sir, hats off to you for that. And the honorary member of the Israeli Rhinology Society, the editorial board member for the Archives of Clinical Otolaryngology and Rhinology, the founder member of the editorial board of Clinical Rhinology, the official journal of the All India Rhinology Society, is a reviewer for various national and international journals, including the Laryngoscope, 60 publications in national and international journals. And if I continue to keep going, instead of having a web series, I will have to keep reading Dr. Ramandeep Work's CV. So I will stop at this level and hand over the today's academic session to Dr. Ramandeep Vak. Sir, welcome and my salutations to you.
Thank you so much. So the topic given to me today was chronic rhinosinusitis. My main work usually lies in allergic fungal rhinosinusitis. So I've tried to make a evidence-based, basic structured talk on chronic rhinosinusitis. I hope it's not too boring because, there's a lot of theoretical part in it. And I have added one or two videos, which I would like to share also. The surgical part and the complication part, Hital ma'am would be speaking after my talk is over. So let's begin. So the topic for today, chronic rhinosinusitis, pathogenesis, diagnosis, complications, and management. So by definition, what exactly is sinusitis? I still see a lot of people using the term sinusitis loosely. So it is the term commonly used for any inflammation or infection of the sinus. Many times we have a patient come into our clinic and say, oh, Dr. Sub, I'm suffering from sinusitis. So it's also a term which is very loosely used. But we need to understand as physicians and as surgeons that the term sinusitis has been replaced by the term rhinosinusitis. Because the nose is almost always involved with infection or inflammation at the same time as the sinuses. So hence, to all the PGs who are logged on, rhinosinusitis is the correct term. And it is defined as a group of disorders characterized by inflammation of the mucosa of the paranasal sinuses and the nasal cavity. So if we broadly classify it, my talk would be on chronic, but what is acute and what is chronic, what is subacute? Acute is which lasts from 7 days but less than 4 weeks. Subacute is 4 to 12 weeks. Recurrent acute is more than 4 episodes of acute rhinosinusitis per year. And CRS or chronic rhinosinusitis, which I'll be speaking on, is duration of more than 12 weeks. So any rhinosinusitis which has lasted for more than 12 weeks is called chronic rhinosinusitis. And the short form is CRS. The clinical definitions of rhinosinusitis, as we already discussed, it's the inflammation of the nose and paranasal sinuses characterized by two or more symptoms, either nasal blockage, obstruction, congestion, or interior or posterior nasal discharge, facial pressure or pain, plus minus reduction or loss of smell. In children, cough is also there because usually there would be a post-nasal drip which would irritate the larynx, causing the child to cough. And either endoscopic signs of nasal polyps or mucopurulent discharge primarily from the middle meatus or edema, mucosal obstruction primarily in the middle meatus, or we see CT changes that include mucosal changes within the osteometal complex or the sinuses. So what are the major symptoms and what are the minor symptoms? Major symptoms include facial pain and pressure, facial congestion or fullness, nasal obstruction or blockage, nasal discharge, purulence or discolored posterior drainage, hyposmia or anosmia, purulence on nasal examination, and for acute sinusitis, of course, we have fever. Minor symptoms are headache, fever for non-acute, halitosis, fatigue, dental pain, cough, ear pain, ear pressure, or ear fullness. Many times the patient would come to you with a complaint that my ears are very heavy, and I feel tired the whole day. I don't feel like working. I don't feel like going out. I just want to be confined to, my room, malaise, that kind of thing. So these are all the minor symptoms. So chronic sinusitis or chronic rhinosinusitis, as we call it, the definition is 12 weeks or longer of two or more of the following signs and symptoms. Mucopurulent drainage. It can be interior, it can be posterior or both. Nasal obstruction or congestion, facial pain, pressure or fullness, and decreased sense of smell. And inflammation is documented by one or more of the following findings: purulent, mucus or edema in the middle meatus or interior ethmoid region, polyps in the nasal cavity or the middle meatus, or radiographic image showing inflammation of the paranasal sinuses. Majority of the cases are idiopathic. A small subset occur in association with cartilaginous syndrome, cystic fibrosis, Wegener's granulomatosis, SLE, or HIV. CRS is widely classified into chronic rhinosinusitis without nasal polyposis, or sans nasal polyposis, as it is medically called. We write it as CRS, a small s for sans, and NP, and CRS with the polyposis. So we write it as CRS, a small w for without, and nasal polyposis. Now, chronic rhinosinusitis without nasal polyposis is characterized by an intense edematous stroma in the sinonasal epithelium with albumin deposition, pseudocyst formation, and subepithelial perivascular inflammatory cell infiltration. It is also associated with typical T helper 2 cell skewed eosinophil inflammation with IL-5 and ECP concentration in the polyps. ECP is the eosinophilic cationic protein. Chronic rhinosinusitis sans nasal polyposis is characterized by fibrosis, basement membrane thickening, goblet cell hyperplasia, mononuclear cell infiltration. It exhibits a T helper 1 cell milieu with increased levels of interferon gamma in inflamed sinus mucosa and a low ECP myeloperoxidase ratio. What are the various theories of etiology and pathogenesis? There have been tons and tons of studies. The literature is so confusing that we really don't know why it happens. And of course, there have been theories which have been proven to be somewhat correct, some theories which have completely been debunked. So we have the fungal hypothesis, which attributes all CRS cases to an excessive host response to Alternaria fungi. Then we have the leukotriene hypothesis. It is the defect in the ichnocyte pathway, most closely associated with aspirin intolerance, and also key components in the pathogenesis of other eosinophilic subtypes of CRS. And increased synthesis of pro-inflammatory leukotrienes and decreased synthesis of anti-inflammatory prostaglandins, or the PGE2, has been proposed as the mechanism. This is the leukotriene hypothesis. Then we have the staphylococcal superantigen hypothesis. This was also very popular for a few years, that it's caused due to a superantigen. So what exactly happens? Exotoxins, which are liberated by the staphylococcal bacteria, foster nasal polyposis via effects on the multiple cell types. We have Th-skewing, Treg inhibition, and accentuated eosinophilic and mast cell activity, heightened tissue damage, and of course, remodeling. Treg is the T regulatory cells. Then we have the immune barrier theory. So increased microbial colonization and accentuated barrier damage lead to increased stimulation of the immune system and a compensatory adaptive immune response. And when this response happens, the disease manifests itself. There's also molecular mechanism and a local defect in the STAT3 pathway. And the systemic defect in the STAT3 pathway is seen in Jobs disease. Then we also have the biofilm hypothesis. This was also very popular some time back when they said complete flushing of the sinuses should be there because there is a biofilm which can only be physically broken by irrigation. And Medtronic also came out with an instrument during that time, which is called the hydro debrider. And it basically, after you're done with the surgery, high pressure wash of the sinuses can be done. So what does the biofilm hypothesis say? That the staphylococcal biofilms can serve as etiological agents that cause chronic rhinosinusitis. It can be speculated that a defect in the immune barrier might facilitate formation of biofilms. And biofilm sequester staphylococci, which permit secretion of superantigens that trigger the Th2 skewing and eosinophilic polyposis. And hence, there is polyposis and sinonasal disease. So this is a chart basically showing what exactly happens. There's impaired release of the innate host defense molecules, the beta defensin 2, the psoriasin, and the calprotectin. Then what happens after that? There is colonization by bacteria and fungi, and there is loss of barrier function. Because their colonization takes place, there is a loss of barrier function. Then local elevations of pathogen-associated molecular patterns with the end result of local development of autoimmunity and there is neutrophil degranulation and mast cell regranulation. If there is IgG degranulation, called neutrophil degranulation. For the, with the IgE, it's the mast cell degranulation. Then we come to polypoidal chronic rhinosinusitis, or as we call it, chronic rhinosinusitis with nasal polyposis. So localized nasal polyposis is called CRS with nasal polyposis slash localized. It's a unilateral nasal polyp. It should always be viewed with suspicion, especially in the older patients and in anyone exposed to wood dust. Unilateral polyp may occur as a result of prior inflammatory event, predisposing to sinus osteoobstruction, hypoxia, and subsequent bacterial infection. And CT and biopsy is indicated in order to decide on the medical and surgical treatment strategy. This is if there is localized nasal polyposis or what we call a unilateral polyposis. Then we come to something which we see most commonly, most of the rhinologists will see this most commonly in the practice, called diffuse nasal polyposis. And a number of recognized mechanisms appear to have a role in polyp formation. These include bacterial, fungal sensitization and atopy, as we discussed previously. These may be associated with biofilm formation or frank eosinophilia, both exacerbating and propagating the inflammatory process. And then we can have bilateral nasal polyposis plus aspirin sensitivity plus asthma, or what we call the Samter's triad in aspirin expirated respiratory disease, AERD. This is a CT scan of how it should, a CT scan should look. This is what we call as a whiteout CT scan, or shows pan-sinus opacification. This is a coronal cut, and it is showing opacification of the ethmoid sinuses, the maxillary sinuses, and with heterogeneous areas of hyperattenuation, which is often described as double density. Because you can see here, these are the areas of double density. The intensity of this area lateral in the maxillary sinus is different than what is present in the nasal cavity and the rest of the maxillary sinus. Bacterial superantigen, fungal antigens, and allergic allergens have all been suggested as a mechanism driving T cell activation, IgE and ILF production, resulting in subsequent tissue eosinophilia. Pathogenesis is likely to represent a multifactorial interaction. And in studies, it is identified predominantly Th1 and Th17 pattern within polyp tissue, and in cystic fibrosis patients exhibits a neutrophilia. These highlight the apparent heterogeneous nature of biochemical pathways result in clinical phenotypes of the CRS with nasal polyposis, the couple of phenotypes which we already discussed. Both gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria have been cultured from nasal cavity of patients with nasal polyposis. Recent evidence, like I said, suggests 75% cases can be elicited to have a biofilm. And tissue eosinophilia can be a useful marker of severity and may help predict severity in these patients. So basically, we can prognosticate the disease if we study tissue eosinophilia. Then we have non-polypoidal chronic rhinosinusitis, or CRS sans nasal polyposis. Some cases of CRS sans nasal polyposis may be classified as CRS with nasal polyposis due to polypoidal changes around obstructive sinus ostia, rather than representing more diffuse polyposis as seen in CRS with nasal polyposis. So basically it is sans nasal polyposis, but around the osteomedial complex or the uncinate, many times you get a small polypoid change. Then we can have the localized across chronic rhinosinusitis sans nasal polyposis. And these are typically because of anatomical variation, which may predispose a patient to isolated inflammation in only one of the sinuses as a post-obstructive phenomena. This is very commonly seen in patients who have a deviated nasal septum. They also have a concha bullosa, or they have a Haller cell. So what happens when there is a concha bullosa? The middle meatus gets obstructed, the osteomedial complex can get blocked, the ventilation can be hampered, and a sinonasal disease can manifest itself. Usually correction of the anatomical deformity and removal of the pathology leads to a very good outcome with very, very minimal recurrence rates. Again, depending on the attachment of the uncinate process, some cases may also involve the frontal and interior ethmoid sinuses on the same side. So again, anatomical variation, depending how the uncinate is attached, there might be blockage to the drainage of the frontal sinus or the interior ethmoid cell, and we might have a disease. on many times on endoscopy, we see a bulging uncinate process. I will show you in a video. This happens even in AFRS, and this usually happens in patients in which there is isolated maxillary sinus involvement. So there's a bulging uncinate process where the infection appears to be walled off in the anterior sinuses. So either it is the anterior sinus or the maxillary sinus. The disease kind of expands the uncinate process anteriorly. In 10% of the case, this is odontogenic. Therefore, for all unilateral cases, should undergo oral examination and careful review of the maxillary sinus floor on the CT to look for signs of oroantral fistula. So many times we miss it. Many times the cuts we order are usually very large, so we are not able to see because fistula sometimes can be in millimeters. So for all practical purposes, for rhinology work, when we are ordering a CT, it has to be a high resolution CT scan, minimum 0.75 millimeter cuts in the axial, coronal, or sagittal planes. And the best is to ask the patient to get a CD or get the DICOM files in a pen drive and run it on your own system. That way you can see all the three films correlating with each other on the screen. It makes life much easier. And diffuse non-polypoidal CRS sans nasal polyposis is histologically characterized by fibrosis, goblet cell hyperplasia, basement membrane thickening, subepithelial edema, and mononuclear cell infiltration. There is upregulation of the TGF-beta, which is the transforming growth factor, signaling pathway in patients with CRS sans nasal polyposis, and causing edema formation and excessive collagen deposition associated with fibrosis. When all this takes place, the drainage and the natural aeration of the sinuses is automatically stopped, and hence you get a sinus disease. It is distinct from chronic rhinosinusitis with nasal polyposis, immunologically characterized by a Th1 milieu with increased levels of interferon gamma in the inflamed sinus mucosa and low ECP myeloperoxidase ratio, as we had studied in the past. Then there can be many systemic conditions which can cause rhinosinusitis. We can have the granulomatous diseases which can cause rhinosinusitis, and in fact chronic rhinosinusitis. So Wegener's granulomatosis and sarcoidosis can cause it. It is diagnosed by the elevated ANCA and ACE, typically manifest with intranasal crusting, and many times when you remove the crust you will see a granulation tissue on the septum which bleeds to touch. And a biopsy can be taken and sent for histopathological examination, and that will clinch the diagnosis. Many of these patients of Wegener's and sarcoid will also come with a septal perforation. So if you see any of this, think of a granulomatous disease in your mind. In Wegener's, there is local destruction, like I've always said, with erosion of sinus lamella and septal cartilage. And in sarcoidosis, there is saddle nose deformity. So a patient who comes with nasal obstruction, and if you see a saddle nose deformity, think sarcoid. And if he's coming with nasal obstruction and you see a septal perforation or granulation tissue on the septum with a crust which bleeds once the crust is removed, think of Wegener's, take a biopsy, send for histopathology, and send a test for ANCA and ACE. Then ciliary dyskinesias, as we know, can also cause chronic rhinosinusitis. And primary ciliary dyskinesia with situs inversus or cartilaginous syndrome, as we know it. And patient will have a prior history of otitis media with effusion and also suffer from bronchiectasis. So in this, a diagnosis is usually pretty straightforward. Then they can also have it secondary to immunodeficiency. 30 to 68% patients, which is a big number, with HIV can have CRS or recurrent ARS. And common variable immune deficiency, selective IgA deficiency, IgG subclass deficiency are the immune deficiency that can be detected in CRS. Also patients on immunotherapy, immunomodulating drugs, or many times radiation or chemotherapy can also present with CRS. Then we have asthma and chronic rhinosinusitis, or Sampter's triad, like we were discussing, which consists of a triad of nasal polyposis, aspirin intolerance, and asthma. And asthma symptoms improve when CRS is treated and need for asthma medication decreases. This is very typically seen. If you operate the patient says, my asthma is much better. The inhaler I was taking has been reduced. But once the sinus disease comes back again, the need for asthmatic medication also rises. And the patient will come back saying, my asthma has come back and I'm also having a nasal blockage. These are the subset of patients which are slightly hard to treat if proper protocols are not followed. So what does functional endoscopic sinus surgery do? It improves asthma control while decreasing asthma exacerbations, hospitalizations, and use of systemic and inhaled steroids. So the total medication dose that the patient has to take for asthma is reduced. And patients with poor asthma control should be evaluated for unsuspected rhinosinus. So if you have a patient who's like, we work closely with our respiratory team, and if there is a patient of asthma who is very difficult to control, they usually get a CT scan paranasal sinus themselves. And if they find something in it, they will refer the patient to us. Now we come to the medical management of rhinosinusitis. So medical management should focus on reducing the inflammatory load, normalizing the microbial community, and restoring the mucociliary function. It aims to reduce severity of symptoms and duration of illness and prevent recurrences and complications. Because this has to be told to the patient. Once the patient comes to you, they have in their mind that I am going to a rhinologist. And once either the medicine is given or the surgery is done, I am going to be okay for life. This usually does not happen. And proper patient counseling is mandatory. Otherwise, you are going to have a very unhappy patient. If you have not spoken to the patient, they will go to another surgeon, then they will change another surgeon. And usually once the patient comes to us, they've already had 2 to 3 surgeries and the disease keeps on coming back. So treatment of CRS is primarily medical, with surgery reserved for those who fail a trial of maximal medical therapy, or as we call it, appropriate medical therapy. There are 2 terminologies. Maximal was used in the past. Nowadays, many are using the term called appropriate medical therapy. And secondary chronic rhinosinusitis, manifestation of systemic disease like vasculitis, cystic fibrosis, sarcoid, ileal motility disorder, or a result of focal abnormalities, right? Anatomical obstruction. Treatment mainly directed towards systemic disease or surgical management of that focal abnormality. And medical treatment to facilitate normalization of the sinonasal mucosa. So primary CRS presents with unexplained inflammation of the upper respiratory tract. They have intrinsic mucosal inflammation, local microbial community, and mucociliary dysfunction, towards which medical management is directed. So mucociliary clearance or mucociliary dysfunction also takes place once there is an inflammation of the sinuses. So there are multiple treatment modalities we have to attack the different theories, you say, or the reasons why this disease happened. So treatment targeting intrinsic mucosal inflammation. So mucosal inflammation could be intrinsic, asthma or aspirin, or due to local infection or environmental exposure. So what is the mainstay of treatment? We use the intranasal corticosteroids. They have an excellent safety profile. They have benefit both subset of patients, chronic rhinosinusitis with nasal polyposis and sans nasal polyposis, and very low systemic bioavailability for the second generation compounds like mometasone and fluticasone. So usually if there is a child, we use mometasone. For adults and for bigger children, we can use fluticasone, because mometasone has the minimum systemic bioavailability among the 2 drugs. There is a very low incidence of adverse drug reactions. Most common, usually once you give a steroid spray, patients, parents come back, or the patient comes back, say, I had epistaxis or nasal bleed, or I have irritation, or the spray burns my throat when I spray it. So these are one of the adverse drug reactions that can happen. So what is again important? Patient education regarding drug delivery techniques and need for compliance. Like, we usually have a counselor who would teach the patient how to do a sinonasal lavage or taking the medication properly. Penetration into the unopened sinuses is limited. That is one of the drawback of the intranasal corticosteroids. And greater response to topical therapy often attained postoperatively utilizing direct delivery into the sinus. So once you do the surgery and the sinuses are completely open, obviously the atomized nasal spray is going to have a much further reach. So in few of the studies which have been done by Professor Warmald, they actually showed that penetration into the frontal and the sphenoid sinuses is very, very minimal. So basically, it is going to address the nasal cavity and the middle meatus. So you can have charts in your clinics or centers, which you can hand out to the patient, which shows how a drug is delivered. And many times now on the nasal sprays made by multinational companies, they have a code which you can scan with your phone. It will take you to a website which will show you how to properly take the nasal spray. And normally we say head back and head down position, or the mecha position, reverse mecha position as we call it. So these are few of the instructions which are very important. These are taken from the American Academy of Otolaryngology Head Neck Surgery guidelines. Number one, always shake the bottle well, because if you notice, after some time, the residue of the main drug settles at the bottom and the dilutant remains on the top, which the patient tends to spray into the nose. Look down by bending your neck and looking toward the floor. Put the nozzle just inside your nose using your right hand for the left nozzle and left hand for the right nostril. Aim toward the outer wall, okay, towards the ala, not towards the septum. And squirt once or twice as you have been advised, and then do not aim towards the nasal septum to prevent irritation and bleeding. Change hands and repeat for the other side, and do not sniff hard. If you sniff it very hard, it is immediately going to come into your throat and you are going to end up swallowing the drug with minimal effect in the nasal cavity where it was needed the most. Then the other category of drugs which are very widely used are systemic corticosteroids. And especially with nasal polyposis, we usually give a short course of 2 to 4 weeks of oral steroids. And it has shown an objective reduction in polyp size and subjective improvement of nasal symptoms and quality of life. So even post-surgery, many times we have to give a short course of steroids. And many times we get asked this question, is 1 week enough? Is 5 days of course enough? Is 10 days enough? So what is the basis for 2 to 4 weeks? The course should last at least as long as lifespan of an eosinophil, which is 14 to 21 days. So 2 to 3 weeks we have to give. Don't give a 7 day course because lifespan of an eosinophil is much longer. Patient will have some benefit, but the adequate benefit the patient will not receive. Max dose should be less than 30 to 40 milligram per day. So ideally, you know, a drug like prednisolone can be given at 1 milligram per kg body weight. But we usually start for an 80 kg patient, we will give, you know, 30 to 40 milligram at 0.5 milligram or even less than that per kg, and calculate the dose and give it to him. Maximum dose should be the total accumulative dose should be less than 290 to 1000 milligram to prevent adverse drug reactions. So make sure the total dose you have given over 3 weeks is less than 1000 milligram. This will again depend on body weight. You can calculate that. Courses should be infrequent, enough to protect against osteoporosis and posterior subcapsular cataract. Now, these are two of the feared side effects, which many of the patients already know, that aankh mein to nahi asar padega, haddiyan to nahi kharab hongi. Yes, that can happen with high dosages and frequent dosages. And you have to tell the patient not to self-medicate with steroid. This is very important, because patient comes to you, you give a steroid, he's never felt that better before. Everything disappears, he can breathe normally. He thinks, wow, this is magic, this is amazing. So what he starts to do is, every time he goes through a attack of inflammation of the sinuses, he goes and takes a course of steroids and feels better. And we have had patients who have had, you know, 4, 5, 6 courses of steroids in a year before they, are referred to us or come to us or come with a complication to the eye department and then get referred back to us that the patient was taking, steroids for the last 2 years or 3 years. So patient education and patient counseling is very important with systemic corticosteroids. Then there's a lot of studies going on immunomodulatory antibiotics. And long-time macrolide antibiotics are used for lower respiratory tract infection due to their anti-inflammatory effect. Okay, so antibiotics are not being used for antibacterial effect, but for the anti-inflammatory effect. They target the IL-8, IL-4, TNF-alpha, IFNY, and have predominant effect on neutrophil-mediated inflammation. This is very important. If your patient is a patient of eosinophil-mediated inflammation, then macrolide therapy will not work. Adverse drug reaction, again, gastrointestinal symptoms and increasing levels of resistance. And like I said, it is advised in patients who have a normal IgE or a lowered IgE. If they have a raised IgE, do not think of macrolide antibiotics. Recent research in the past has also shown that a 20-day doxycycline course is shown to reduce levels of myeloperoxidase. So in the past, I told you about the myeloperoxidase ratio. So it reduces the level, adjusts that ratio, eosinophilic cationic protein, matrix metalloprotein is 9, and had a moderated sustained effect on polyp size over a 12-week period. So a 20-day course of doxy, they studied over 3 months, and they found that the shrinkage of the polyp has taken place. Macrolides could be adjunct in non-ECRS, like we discussed, subgroup, whereas doxycycline could be used as an adjunct in the eosinophilic chronic rhinosinusitis group. So this is very important. Once you get the IgE, if it is normal or low, then macrolide. If it is raised, then doxycycline can be considered. Okay, it is an option. It is not in the guidelines for mandatory treatment. Then leukotriene receptor antagonist montoclast as an adjunct to steroid in patients has been used, as it benefits sinusitis as well as asthma. A greater benefit in patients is seen with associated nasal allergy and found to be affected, as allergy might be coexisting in many patients. Then normal immunoregulation, monoclonal antibodies like omalizumab and mepolizumab shown to reduce symptom score and polyp size. These are some of the newer methodologies. They are very expensive per to say, and we at our institute are currently not using them. There is high cost, risk of anaphylaxis and need for subcutaneous injection, which limits its use. And there's also inhibition of the single agent in the pathway. Might not be that effective because though one is inhibited, the others may persist. And many anti-cytokine and anti-chemokine agents are under trial. So, of course, omalizumab has come in for use, and so has mepolizumab, but other agents are also under study, and we are currently not using them. Then, what I had discussed for SAMHSA's triad, it is very important to desensitize the patient prior to surgery. If you have identified it as a SAMHSA's triad, go ahead with aspirin desensitization. Otherwise, your patient, I've seen patients who have undergone 7, 8, 9 surgeries, right? So aspirin sensitivity is usually associated with nasal polyposis and asthma, which we call SAMHSA's triad. Immune tolerance may be achieved and maintained with regular administration of aspirin. We use orally. Lysine aspirin used for diagnosis of aspirin sensitivity by nasal or bronchial challenge and for topical nasal desensitization. We use oral aspirin, and at our institute, we are using about 400 milligram a day. So there are a couple of studies which have shown that even low dose aspirin given at the dose of 200 milligram BD is as sufficient as high dose like 650 milligram BD. There's significant reduction in need for systemic and topical steroids and decrease in sinus infections. It is recommended for asthmatics, unresponsive to medical therapy, requiring high systemic steroid doses, and severe polyposis with repeated sinus surgery. Like I said, we have had patients who have undergone 7, 8, 9 surgeries, and they have responded dramatically with aspirin desensitization. But the key here is, do not do desensitization on an OPD basis. We usually admit the patient under medicine, in case, though I have not seen an allergic response to aspirin, but theoretically it can happen. And it is always safer to have an admitted patient to manage, and then gradually start with 60 milligram, then 90 milligram, then 150 milligram, then 200 milligram, and gradually build up to the minimum dose you have to give to the patient. Then we can reduce microbial load, and bacteria may play a role in acute infective inflammations or flare-up of the disease. Antibiotics should not be given blindly. These are the guidelines also mentioned in the position paper and key action statements of the American Academy and the European position paper on sinusitis. If you have to give them culture-directed and short-term. So like we discussed, doxycycline reduced post-nasal drip, but no effect on anosmia, rhinorrhea, or nasal congestion. So could be used as an adjunct, right? Not as a primary treatment, but as an adjunct in chronic rhinosinusitis with nasal polyposis. Then biofilms, bacterial and fungal, have been demonstrated with sinuses of CRS patients associated with more severe disease and recalcitrance to surgical therapy. Systemic antibiotics are relatively ineffective against biofilms. So like I said, it has to be a physical disruption. Topical antibiotics and surfactants also are more beneficial after surgery and has a limited role in treatment in pre-op patients. And topical antifungals have not been proven to be effective in any group of chronic rhinosinusitis. This is again one of the most discussed topic in any conference you go, that we put the patient on itraconazole, voriconazole. Do not do that. Studies have shown that their effect is short term. The amount of side effects you have with antifungals is much more compared to a steroid therapy. They are much more expensive. So you are actually gaining nothing by giving an antifungal medication. We can improve mucociliary clearance, and normally it is dependent on both ciliary function and the mucus blanket, which engulfs the cilia. Saline irrigation of large volumes improves mucociliary clearance by removal of mucus and the crust and the pro-inflammatory agents. And correct technique of irrigation should be advised. So normally, advise a patient head bent downwards, or we call it the reverse mecha position, flush from one side, let it flow out from the other side. You can use the neti pot. Many patients are already doing yoga. You can continue using that. You can use pressurized bottles. And you can, for poor patients who can't afford any of this, even a 50 ml syringe can be useful. Then we have the mucoactive agents. Surfactants are amphiatic molecules that are soluble in both water and organic solutions. They have both antimicrobial and mucoactive properties. Chemical surfactants interfere with microbial cell membrane permeability and cause membrane rupture. And there are three types, cationic, anionic, and zwitterionic, based on charge of the hydrophilic domain. Out of these three, the cationic possesses the most antimicrobial properties, but is also most irritating. So the patient will complain of irritation. And it helps in treating thick mucus, chronic bacterial mucus colonization. These are still under study, not really being used commonly. And I don't think so they can replace a well-done full house fest, as we call it, or a complete sinus surgery. Then delivery of drug therapy. In preoperative cases, topical therapies reach only the nasal cavity, potentially treating nasal polyps and edema at the osteometal complex. As I had already told you, that there are studies by Professor Wormald which shows that medications don't go into the inner sinuses. They can treat turbinate hypertrophy. So systemic therapy needed to treat sinus mucosa. And in post-op cases, topical therapy plays major role in disease control. So if a patient comes with you, bilateral extensive nasal polyposis, put the patient on systemic therapy. After the surgery is done and the cavities are open and large, put the patient on topical therapy. Don't do the reverse. Okay? Extensive disease, your nasal spray is just going to stay in the nasal cavity. It is not even going to go in any of the sinuses. Right? And endoscopic sinus surgery can improve drug delivery. And the minimal ostial size, if you look at the studies, people ask, how large can I make it? How large is depending on how easy, how comfortable are you in removing the disease, whether you are able to remove the disease from a smaller opening, or when you are young or inexperienced, you need to create a bigger opening to remove the disease. But it should not be less than 4 millimeter. So 4 millimeter is the minimum size to achieve maximal sinus penetration of topical therapy. So that is minimal. The large will depend upon your surgical experience. The experienced surgeons can usually use angled endoscopes, angled suctions, and get away with a smaller opening. Then we have various delivery devices. We have already discussed. They can have neti pots, the syringes, the motorized devices. Then assessment of respond to medical treatment. So once the patient has come to you, you have given medical therapy. And what exactly will be called the response to treatment, that the patient says, okay, I'm better, is a relief of symptoms to the point that they are no longer present or bothersome. That patient says that I can carry on my work. I don't think about my disease anymore. I can breathe well. If this is maintained with or without medication, then disease is said to be controlled. So let's say if you say, okay, so your systemic steroids are over. Now there is minimal disease. You can start taking nasal sprays. And if you can maintain the patient on nasal spray, patient will not require surgery. So there are basically various scales like the VAS scale, the European position paper, like I said, on sinusitis guidelines, or recently proposed NOSE guidelines, which consist of nasal obstruction, systemic medication, and endoscopy. And control of disease is to prevent infective exacerbations and control baseline symptoms. So that you're, as a surgeon, as a ENT physician, that is your purpose, that they don't flare up repeatedly. And many times you can tell the patient that when there is the allergic season, usually harvesting of the crops in North India, March, April, and October, November, that is the time your allergies are going to flare up. You can start washes and your nasal sprays. You don't need to come back to hospital because that is going to how it is going to remain always. Minimum 4 to 8 weeks of treatment is needed before assessment of response. Make sure you counsel your patient and tell him that ek do mahine to lagenge. Don't offer him magical results that you take the medicine by next week, you will feel better. It is not going to happen. Everything takes time. It's a chronic disease. Medicine is going to go in, get absorbed, then have its effect. Improvement but incomplete resolution, then what do we do? Continue treatment. Symptomatic or asymptomatic with a normal endoscopy on or CT, continue treatment. If the patient is asymptomatic with normal mucosa and endoscopy, treatment can be withdrawn. So patient has come to you after steroid therapy, you put in an endoscope, it is normal, you can see the middle meatus, everything is normal, stop the therapy, right? So when do we think of surgery? When there is no improvement to treatment, history and examination should be reviewed to ensure correct diagnosis, number one, so that there are no granulomatous diseases, you're not missed out on cystic fibrosis or any other diseases, and to exclude symptoms, amplifiers like depression. That is also very important. Secondary CRS should be considered and investigated for, and smoking cessation should be advised. This is one which has really helped a lot. And many times, honestly, I forget to ask the patient whether he smokes or not, and the patient continues to smoke. It is only in one of the later visits, the patient is smelling of cigarettes, you realize, oh, he's a smoker, and then you advise him. So have this on your checklist. Ask for smoking. If yes, patient is to stop smoking. If no response, we should plan for surgery after CT, even with positive endoscopy, as an aid to surgery and to exclude fungal ball, allergic fungal sinusitis, or neoplasia. So don't operate without a CT scan. Following doesn't warrant trial of medical management. So these are a few conditions. Unilateral polypoidal disease, like I said, and especially if the age group is above 50, think of tumors or malignancy. Or if you're having a suspicion of malignancy, inverted papilloma, go ahead with surgery after you see the CT scan. And associated neurological or orbital symptoms. Now with this lockdown, I will be showing you a video of a case. Normally, AFRS patient comes to us, with reducing vision. Patient is put on steroids and operated as soon as possible. That can mean within 24 to 48 hours. But in this lockdown, what happened? A few of our patients we got who had AFRS were randomly taking antibiotics. By the time they came to us, the patients were blind. So yes, fungal sinusitis, chronic rhinosinusitis can cause blindness. So if they are having any neurological or orbital symptoms, go ahead with surgery. So what is failure of medical therapy? It is defined by patient-focused outcomes and not mucosal inflammation. If the patient says, I can breathe, I'm happy, and you see edema, a little bit of polyps in the middle meatus, don't advise surgery because the patient is already happy. You doing surgery is not going to add anything to that. There's a high symptom burden despite treatment and have repeat infective flare-ups. Need for more than two courses of systemic treatments per year. So this is very important. You've given the patient two courses of steroids. When do you operate? This is the time frame. So if you have given two courses per year, go ahead and perform an endoscopic sinus surgery on the patient. And cases that didn't show improvement with pre-surgical medication treatment, they fulfill the diagnostic criteria for CRS, where alternative diagnosis is not found and there's confirmed mucosal disease on CT, go ahead with a surgery. So failure of medical therapy, there is no secondary chronic rhinosinusitis, CT shows mucosal disease, go ahead with a surgery. Now we come to the part of medical treatment post-surgery. Normally when patients get operated, they have this thing in their mind that I'm going to be free of disease for life. That is why I said in this, counseling is very important. Talk to the patient, it is very important. Otherwise you're going to have a huge number of unhappy patients with you who are going to be going from one physician to the other that I got operated, dot sub ne surgery kar di, I'm still not okay. So surgery of course should be complete. Dr. Hetal is going to be speaking on that. It should be wide and designed to remodel the paranasal sinus to a common cavity that can be managed, especially important in chronic rhinosinusitis with nasal polyposis. So why a common cavity? Number one, examination is easy. You put in an endoscope, you can see the maxillary sinus, sphenoid, the skull base and the frontal sinus all in one go. I'll also show you a small clip why we do that. Then hypersecretory mucus removed and anti-inflammatory treatment is delivered. We need an open cavity so that steroidal douching, steroidal wash, and steroid sprays can reach everywhere. So if there is one common cavity, like a big room, the drug is going to get delivered very well. So this is a short video. This is a video of that patient who had come with blindness, though this is a patient of allergic fungal rhinosinusitis. Patient came, was completely blind, and we found that the optic nerve was dehiscent and the sphenoid sinus was full of muck, which was causing pressure and probably fungal toxins, which caused to blindness. And the unfortunate part is the patient is young, and even after surgery, the blindness has not recovered. So and normally a patient like this would come in non-COVID times, would come to you within 24 to 48 hours and have a better outcome. But this patient came to us after 4 months. So we are doing nasal decongestion. This is the right nasal cavity. This is inferior turbinate. I'm creating space in the lower part by infracturing the inferior turbinate and then out fracturing it. So this keeps the inferior turbinate out of my way. It creates giving me a wide room. Then the middle meatus has been decongested, and you can see this is what I wanted to show you, a ballooned out uncinate process, what we were talking about in the lecture. Then using a coblator on the uncinate, we coblate away the mucosa. I do this because it gives me a clear field, minimal bleeding. Otherwise, just by going through the uncinate many times, there is bleeding and the anatomy is not very clear. So for teaching purposes, this is very convenient. And even if there's bleed, the coagulation mode of the coblator can take away that bleed. So once the mucosa is done, because mucosa is the one that bleeds, the ball probe, we slightly bring the uncinate forward so that I can engage my backbiting. Since it's a smaller backbiting, 2 to 3 bites can be taken. See the direction, it is inferomedial. So I'm going downwards and then another bite. So this helps me in a couple of things. Number one, it opens up the maxillary sinus. With a ball probe, I'm going to pull out the lower part of the uncinate, the horizontal portion. And secondly, it gives me a notch to engage my microdebrider. So a notch has already been created with the backbiting, my microdebrider can be engaged. So I'm using an angled 40-degree microdebrider, and notice the minimal bleeding because the mucosa of the uncinate has been coblated. Make sure the uncinate is completely removed. There are a couple of complications that can happen. Hital ma'am would be talking about those. So I'm taking away completely the uncinate, and make sure you take away the upper part also. Otherwise, your frontal recess area will not open. Usually, like, there is an axilla which is going to block. So shift over to a 45 degree endoscope. You can see the frontal recess area and the opening into the frontal sinus. This is an intact bulla technique. We have not opened the bulla as yet. Then using a microdebrider, I'm widening the maxillary ostia. I'm taking away the polyps. And you can see the fungal muck in the maxillary sinus has come into view. And the maxillary sinus is packed with it. Easiest way to remove it is irrigation. Don't try to suction it or catch it with a forceps. It is not going to happen. I'm widening, cutting through the posterior fontanelle. Some amount of bleeding does come near the sphenopalatine foramen because of twigs of the sphenopalatine vessel. Once that is done, I use the microdebrider to widen the maxillary antrum once more. The lower part of the uncinate, some of it is still left. I'm using a downward Stamberger punch, and 2 or 3 punches will remove that. Then using a 50 ml irrigation syringe, we just flush the sinuses 3, 4, 5, 6 times, and the muck will come out. See how the water pushes the muck out. So just by pure pressure, it is pushing the muck out. So make sure you give 5 or 6 washes. Rather than trying to suction it or holding it with the forceps, it is going to be very frustrating. So once the muck is loosened, it can be easily suctioned out with a bigger suction. Then switch over to a 45 degree and examine the maxillary sinus. See that the interior wall, because you can have muck sticking there. So that is the interior and the lateral wall of the maxillary sinus. You can see still a little amount of muck, which can be removed. Using an upcut, we cut through the axilla. We open up the agar nasi cell. There is usually some amount of bleed here, which can be controlled easily. So that's the agar nasi which has been opened up. We need to uncap it. A patient had a small agar. So once that is uncapped, you will see how the frontal recess is widely accessible. I have still not removed the bulla because I am doing an intact bulla technique, which I feel is safer because it protects the interior ethmoidal artery. So once that is done, the frontal recess and the frontal sinus are completely visible. I go in and widen it a little bit because this patient has been on steroids. He had much more disease than what we can see. And it is going to come back if I don't open the sinuses wide and put him on postoperative medical management and steroidal douches. So I'm just widening the maxillary sinus, taking out all the fungus, and you can see the frontal sinus completely opened up. Then we address the bulla using a micro debrider. I am doing a complete bulla removal. The outside mucosa, you can see the thin bone. And a complete bulla removal is done for right from the orbit laterally to the middle turbinate medially. You can still see some amount of fungal muck, which the steroids did not address. So once that is done, I will go medially between the corridor of the middle turbinate, head on onto the sphenoid sinus. So you can see the orbital wall. The patient also had erosion of the lamina papyracea and some amount of proptosis because the fungal muck was pushing against the orbital wall. I am lateralizing the middle turbinate and I'm seeing some polyposis between the middle and the superior turbinate. Once I remove that, you can see the superior turbinate. And because this muck was completely filling the sphenoid sinus on CT, we went through the corridor between the septum and the middle turbinate. So from the cuvana, 1.5 to 2 centimeters, go directly into the sphenoid sinus and open it up widely. Now see how densely the muck is packed into the sphenoid sinus, and the patient had a dehiscent optic nerve, and that was the cause of his blindness. Again, removal remains the same. Irrigation, 300-400 ml of saline. Just push it out completely, and the sphenoid sinus starts to clear up. So quite a lot has been cleared, and I can easily see the optic nerve, which is pointed by the arrow, and it is hanging into the sphenoid sinus. Then we identify the superior turbinate. I'm back in the middle meatus. And I'll show you the keratooptic recess and the dehiscent optic nerve. And you open up the posterior ethmoid, which is the largest posterior ethmoid cell. Once that is done, I go into the sphenoid sinus inferomedially. And so now the sphenoid is connected from both sides, from the posterior ethmoid and from the other corridor. Snipped the lower part of the superior turbinate so as to make it one big cavity so that the disease, even if it comes back, has a place to drain. We were hoping the vision would come back, but unfortunately, that is the dehiscent optic nerve. That is the keratooptic recess. And that lower down was the clivus. So that would usually complete the procedure of a functional endoscopic sinus surgery. So then we come to corticosteroid irrigation. So after surgery is done, postoperative steroid irrigation, we usually have butycod respules, which we break and put into 100 ml of saline. Key is it has to be large volume. You don't irrigate the sinuses post-surgery with 10, 20, 30, 40 ml. It has to be 100 to 200 ml. Okay. And they are effective. They are low dose, low absorption, and they deliver drug to the sinus mucosa directly. And Now, in the last few slides, I will just go through the American Academy guidelines for management of ARS and CRS. We'll be covering the CRS. The clinician should distinguish presumed acute bacterial rhinosinusitis from ARS caused by viral upper respiratory infection and non-infectious conditions. Radiographic and imaging should be done, and it should not obtain imaging for patients who meet diagnostic criteria for ARS. So for ARS, do not go for imaging. For CRS, yes. For fungal, yes. Unless you suspect a complication, then in ARS, you can go in for imaging. And symptomatic relief of viral rhinosinusitis, you don't need to recommend any antibiotics. You can recommend analgesics, topical intranasal steroids, or nasal saline irrigation. It's usually going to get controlled on its own. For diagnosis of CRS, confirm a clinical diagnosis of CRS with objective documentation of sinonasal inflammation by anterior rhinoscopy or nasal endoscopy or a CT. Assess the patient with CRS for multiple chronic conditions like we had discussed in the past, such as asthma, cystic fibrosis, immunocompromised state, ancillary dyskinesia, and test for allergy and immune function. Confirm the polyps of confirm for the presence of polyps in chronic rhinosinusitis. Start the patient on topical intranasal therapy. It is recommended saline nasal irrigation for mucociliary clearance, topical intranasal corticosteroids, or both for symptom relief. So I usually put the patient on both. So I tell them, wash your sinus first, get the the thick mucus out, and then spray your nose. Antifungal therapy for chronic rhinosinusitis, both EPOS and American Academy say that they should not prescribe topical or systemic antifungal therapy. So no voriconazole or itraconazole should be prescribed. And this is a flow chart. I mean, you can get it online if the duration is more than 12 weeks, how you go through it. This is a very small clip on which there was an anatomical deformity. There is a paradoxical middle turbinate. This is again steroid treated. The reason I want to show you this video is that pre-op good medical management is very important. Again, see the uncinate has become polypoidal. You can see I'm elevating it with the ball probe. It is a polypoid.
Dr. Raman.
Yes, sir.
Sorry to interrupt you. How many more minutes do we have from your side?
I think 1 minute more.
Okay. Done. Done, okay. Sir. Okay. Yeah.
So again, so this is one of the conditions which was chronic rhinosinusitis, but localized, that the uncinate is getting polypoidal and some amount of the osteomatal complex is getting polypoidal. So this was a subset which we had discussed in the start. One is generalized, one is localized. This was the localized form of disease. So in this, I just wanted to show you the uncinate, which was polypoidal, and the osteomatal complex, which was polypoidal. The procedure, Hital ma'am will discuss, it remains the same practically. I do the intact bullet technique. Other surgeons have various other techniques which they can use. You can see some amount of inflammation of the mucosa in the maxillary antrum, but otherwise there is no disease. So this is CRS, sans nasal polyposis, with limited polyposis of the osteomedial complex and the uncinate process. Okay. So thank you very much. And thank you for being patient. There was a lot of theory in it, which even kind of, bores me.
Thank you, Dr. Raman, sir. Wonderful presentation. A lot of take-home points, even for all of us. The lovely slides and beautiful videos too.
Thank you
so much. We'll have a quick question answer session.
Okay.
I have a couple of questions which has come in.
Right.
So kindly take the questions. We have Dr. Prakash Munka from Bokaro Steel City. His question is rhinitis and bronchial asthma, which comes first? And
so usually bronchial asthma comes first. That is what we are having a study in our department, and it has come out that usually patients will have symptoms of asthma first. But that again, sir, we need to see that can again be boiled down to the fact that a patient will be more scared with symptoms of asthma than a little nasal discharge. So his point of presentation to the hospital will be to the pulmonology people because he can't breathe. He is having sounds in his chest. His wife is scared, you know. So they usually come to the pulmonology people.
Okay. He has another question. Treatment with intranasal corticosteroids should be start with azelastin and fluticasone, and then continue with fluticasone or mometasone in children.
Yes, that very valid answer. Actually, azelastin is a very quick acting drug. So you can actually control symptoms faster if you want a happier patient. We will also usually put the patient, if it's an adult, on Furemist AZ. And then, after 4 weeks or 6 weeks, shift on to simple fluticasone. For children, especially below, 7-8 years, we do not use fluticasone. We are using only mometasone. And montelukast in children is not to be given. It is on the FDA radar for causing sleep disturbances. I've seen many times a child has come prescribed with montelukast that they are taking a tablet montelukast. Okay. Now, if you ask specific history, that is the child having bad dreams or disturbed sleep, the parents will say yes, they see things. So it affects them psychologically.
Okay. Thank you, sir, for that answer. We have Mohammed Sirajuddin from Chennai. What about combination spray azelastin plus fluticasone for chronic rhinosinusitis?
Yes, we already discussed that azelastin will control the symptoms of allergy much quicker than a pure steroid, which will kick in within 7 to 10 days.
Srinivas, yes, I think madam. We can start the next talk. The questions we can take at the end of the session.
At the end of the session, right.
Yeah.
Okay. We have a couple of questions pending. We'll keep them pending.
Yes, sir. No problem.
And once madam finishes, probably we'll take it up later. Thank you so much, sir, for a wonderful presentation.
Thank you, Srinivas.
Dr. Bharti, madam.
Yeah. Raman, it was a good sort of lucid talk. You have covered the entire spectrum in 1 hour. It was really, I enjoyed the talk, Raman. Your video is also good. Now we'll move on to the second session. The second session, the speaker is Dr. Hetal, my close friend, and the moderator is Dr. Bharat Kakan, is a senior consultant from Rajkot. He has got 30 years of experience of various. His field of interest is like entire, otorhinolaryngology, head and neck, all the in this entire spectrum of surgeries he does. He has got many numbers, varying from 500 minimum to 3,000 numbers of surgeries he has done. He is attached to Lions Hospital and then visiting consultant to Oakard and Starling Hospitals. And then he has got various publication, is an invited speaker nationally as well as in his regional state conferences. I hand over the platform to Dr. Bharat. Hello, Dr. Bharat.
Hello.
Yeah.
Good evening, everyone.
Yeah,
good evening. President, President-elect, Secretary, and both the speakers and my co-moderator, Dr. Srinivasan. It was a very nice opportunity to meet you all. And we are having two speakers, both are professors from very premier institute of our nation. We had enjoyed the talk of Dr. Raman. Now we are having Dr. Hetal. She is a professor and head of department at prestigious at GS Medical College and KM Hospital, Mumbai. She has done her training at KM Hospital and has done fellowship in endoscopic sinus surgery at Graz, Austria, and skull-based fellowship at the Pittsburgh and the University of Pennsylvania. She is a recipient of prestigious EMERC, RF Cooper, and CIGA awards. She has a numerous publication in various national and international journals, and she is invited as a faculty all over the country and abroad for training in the otology and face. We Rajkot is also fortunate to have her before, I think 1.5 decade before, and she had performed so many surgery at that time. She is a versatile surgeon, adept at endoscopic sinus surgery, cochlear implants, microlaryngeal surgery, and her recent passion is Baha. Very interesting. She has started a club for patients with microtia and anotia. under the name of Ear for All at KM Hospital, Mumbai. She is running the largest cochlear implant program in Civic Hospital. So this is a very small, brief curriculum vitae of Dr. Ethel. She is very dynamic and very young and providing excellent services to the KM Hospital. I proudly presenting her, and I am requesting her to present her today's topic about the chronic rhinosinusitis and the complications and techniques. Dr. Ethel, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much for this kind introduction. I also thank AOI for giving me this opportunity to share my experience here. And thank you very much to all the residents to spare their valuable time on a rainy evening to sit in front of the computer. It's difficult. I'll try and make it as simple as possible and as interesting as possible. Without much ado, we'll start with the topic. Today, I'm going to share my experience on endoscopic sinus surgery, the technique of it, and complication. What I'm going to do is I'm going to restrict the talk to basic endoscopic sinus surgery rather than going too much onto the skull base. So without much ado, I will start my presentation. Is the screen shared?
Yeah.
So this is my armamentum where I've got most of my experience. When we talk about endoscopic sinus surgery, we cannot forget Professor Meser Klinger. His good old work on the cadaver and study on the mucociliary system has changed the entire perspective towards the sinus surgery. The good old Caldwell-Lock surgery, which stood the test of time for about 100 years, lost its importance just by his studies. What he did was he studied the cadaver and saw the mucociliary clearance using the colored particle. And this is the cadaver video which I borrowed from his department, which shows that the mucociliary clearance occurs and it goes towards the natural ostium. Here you can see the same happens in the frontal sinus. So all the external surgeries which were offered lost its importance and everybody started focusing towards the ostium. With the advent in the, and Professor Stamberger made it available to all over the world, he introduced the concept of endoscopic sinus surgery. The first visitor to his department, Dr. David Kennedy, when he visited the department and he realized that this entire surgery is towards improving the function of the sinus and improving the aeration as well as drainage of the paranasal sinuses, and he coined the term FESS. It is to improve the function of sinuses. Over the years, as the endoscopic sinus surgery became more and more familiar, it had it extended use, and it is not only used to improve the function of the paranasal sinuses, but much beyond to handle all the diseases and pathology within the paranasal sinuses and beyond. And hence the terminology from FESS has shifted to endoscopic sinus surgery. In our country, Dr. Kirtane and Dr. Sethi has popularized much of the aspects of endoscopic sinus surgery. And not to forget Dr. Peter Wormald also, who comes every year to share his knowledge. As you enter the nasal cavity, your first and foremost landmark in the nasal cavity is a middle turbinate. And middle turbinate, I consider it like a lighthouse. It tells you where to go and where not to go. If you see this middle turbinate, it is attached at the junction of medial lamella and the lateral lamella. And at that junction, that area is further weakened by traversing the anterior ethmoidal artery. when we are talking about the endoscopic sinus surgery, the variations, anatomical variations within the nasal cavity can also invite sinusitis. Like here, you can see that there is a right sided maxillary sinusitis. There is a huge concha bullosa in the left nasal cavity. There is a deviated nasal septum, and there's a crowding in the right osteometal complex. Had it been the same side, it can also affect the paranasal sinus here and cause sinusitis. Now, in this situation, if you have at times the concha, which can be infected from within, like here you can see that it's an infected concha and there is a sinusitis on the same side. So a lot of time just clearing the anatomical variations and creating more space in the osteometal complex can revert the disease and help the reversion of the sinusitis. So here I have taken a slide with a non-infected concha just to show that presence of concha is causing crowding of the osteometal region. And if you have this concha which is causing the problem, you can remove the lateral half of this concha and create a wide space in the osteometal complex and revert the disease process. So just doing a minimally invasive surgery can revert the disease. Here you are in the right nasal cavity. You are seeing the septum here. You are seeing the middle turbinate, uncinate process, the vertical part of the uncinate process. But here you have a large bulla, which can invite frontal and anterior ethmoiditis. And as you go backwards, you have another landmark, and that is the superior turbinate, and which causes which gives you a landmark for a sphenoid ostium. Our most of the surgery happens in the lateral part to the middle turbinate. And if you see the cross section of the lateral wall of the nasal, lateral nasal wall, here you are seeing a frontal sinus and you have a four lamella, the first lamella being the uncinate process. And here you can see that there is a, it is covering the maxillary ostium. So if you take care of the uncinate process, remove the uncinate process, then you will get exposure to the frontal sinus and the maxillary sinus. The first lamella, which is a uncinate process, is a boomerang shape. It has got two parts. It has got a vertical part and the horizontal part. And the junction of that can be removed using a backward biting forceps, and the rest of the part can be removed. The upper part can be removed using either a micro debrider or a sickle knife or a punch forceps. Here, the similar thing is shown that removal of the uncinate process can give you an exposure to the maxillary sinus. The uncinectomy can be done either with the sickle knife, but one has to make sure the sickle knife is running parallel to the lateral nasal wall. While doing the uncinectomy, if you take care, one has to take care that there is no raw area. Here you are seeing that there is a raw area created on the middle turbinate, and that tends to move the turbinate laterally postoperatively. So your entire surgery, which is done very nicely, is destroyed. So this should be taken care of, that such postoperative adhesions are avoided, and for that meticulous or traumatic surgery is the key.
Open the door.
The incident process can be attached to the lateral nasal wall, and it can have various attachments. Here you are seeing the terminal recess, and terminal recess, it is attaching to the lamina papyracea, forming a terminal recess. A lot of time this terminal recess is mistaken with the frontal sinus. As I told you that once you do a good uncinotomy, the lower part of the uncinate, if removed completely or nicely, can give you an access to the maxillary ostium. One must see that here you are seeing the accessory ostium. When you see the ostium without doing an uncinotomy, it is by default a accessory ostium. Sometime you can have it, the anterior accessory ostium, and sometime you can have a posterior accessory ostium. The here you can see the AC entroconal polyp, which is re-deflected, and what you are seeing is the. Accessory ostia, and one needs to connect them to give a good aeration to the maxillary sinus. The ostium widening can be done either using a ostrum's forceps, or it can be done using the through-cut forceps, or debrider can be used, and the pathology within can be dealt. One point to remember that sometimes the uncinate process can run very close to the lamina papyracea, and this should be identified preoperatively. And here you are seeing that it is very, very close to the lamina papyracea. Doing an uncinectomy using a sickle knife, it is very easy to enter the lamina papyracea. So in this situation, you must do with the reverse biting forceps or ostrum's forceps. Otherwise, very easy to get the fat prolapse within the nasal cavity. Now, this is the first step. Uncinectomy is a first step towards endoscopic sinus surgery. And when doing a first step and you get the fat prolapse, you get disturbed. But one should not. The point is to identify that there is a fat prolapse. And the other thing is that this fat, which is prolapse, should not come in your suction. One should cover that either with the sialastic sheet and go ahead and do the further surgery and ensure that this fat doesn't get caught in the debrider. So one has to be very, very careful if such thing happens. One must identify, and to identify whether it is a fat or any other structure, what you can do is you can do a pressure on the eyeball, and if that moves, that means it is a fat. That is known as a positive Stankovic sign. Your second lamella after doing a good uncinectomy is a bulla ethmoidalis. Here you are seeing that there is a large bulla. A part of the upper part of the uncinate is still remaining here. So when you are doing a second lamella and clear the anterior ethmoid cells, you will have medially the middle turbinate, laterally the lamina papyracea. I'm sorry. You can have laterally the lamina papyracea. Superiorly, you will have the base skull where you can see the anterior ethmoidal artery. Now, if you are doing a standard technique and you are going through the bulla ethmoidalis, you must identify, or you must be careful about the anterior ethmoidal artery. At times, this anterior ethmoidal artery is lies bare, or it is dehiscent. It's not running in the bony canal, and it can be access to the injury. Lot of time, the anterior ethmoidal artery gets minimally punctured, and you get the bleeding from the anterior ethmoidal artery, and one must take care of it by using a bipolar cautery. Sometime, this is one of the case where you could see that there was an anterior ethmoidal artery completely lying bare, and there was extensive polyposis. This was one of the revision case, and one had to be very, very careful in such scenario. If you want to go beyond, then you must use bipolar cautery and cauterize both the ends. Otherwise, the bleeding end can get retracted and we can have orbital hematoma. We'll come to that little later. So once your bullae modalis is taken care of, your third lamella is a ground lamella. Entering the ground lamella will give you an access to the posterior ethmoid cells. If you see, the posterior ethmoid cells are usually large in size. And here, incidentally, the ground lamella is also pneumatized. The ground lamella is a part of the middle turbinate which is attached laterally, and it causes the partition between the anterior and the posterior ethmoid cells. Sometimes the posterior ethmoid cells are so well pneumatized that they go beyond the anterior face of the sphenoid and tend to have relationship with the optic nerve, and that is known as the Onodi cell. This is the very famous diagram from Professor Stemberger's textbook, where you can see the posterior ethmoid cells, which is the Onodi cell in relation to the optic nerve, as well as the sphenoid, which is in relation to the optic nerve. This variation can be easily identified on the CT scan. And when you are dealing with the Onodi cell, you are here, this is a striking optic nerve is seen, but if you see it carefully, you are seeing the posterior ethmoidal artery. That means you are still in the posterior ethmoid. And when the and when there is a large Onodi cell, the sphenoid tends to be very small. And here you can see a small sphenoid sinus. Here you are seeing a striking optic nerve within the Onodi cell, which can be picked up in preoperatively on the CT scan. Sometimes this optic nerve can be dehiscent, and one needs to identify it, and one has to be very careful not projecting any instrument laterally, and one has to be very, very careful with the powered instruments. Otherwise, you can have direct injury to the optic nerve. Coming to the last lamella, and that is the sphenoid anterior face. So superior turbinate, as we already discussed, gives you a landmark for reaching the sphenoid ostium. But if you are going by a standard technique, then one needs to go inferomedially after doing a posterior ethmoid dissection. Also, the choanal arch serves as a landmark for identifying the sphenoid ostium. It lies about 1.5 centimeter above the choanal arch. So when you are operating in the direction, if you continue to operate in the same direction, it's very easy to enter the cranial cavity. So one must turn the instruments inferiorly and medially to enter the sphenoid sinus. Here, as you see, the sphenoid sinus is very, very large. So one must see that at times the sphenoid can be large, dominant sphenoid, and the corresponding sphenoid on the other side can be very tiny. Apart from the intersphenoid septum, which rarely divides the sphenoid into two equal halves, and it's rarely in the midline, the landmark for the midline remains the vomer or rostrum of the sphenoid. The rostrum tells you about the midline, and you can have additionally multiple septae, which are known as intrasphenoid septae. They are very notorious. They tend to go towards the important structures, like here it's going to the optic nerve, and here it's going towards the carotid. Here you can see that you can have multiple septae within the sphenoid sinus. Here you can see that there are three partitions, so one may mistake this. The extreme part may be missed, and you may find that as two separate half of the sphenoid, and you may forget the pathology here. So one has to be very careful about that. And as I told you, this intrasphenoid septae are notorious. Here they're going towards the attaching to the optic nerve. If you see the relationship here, you are seeing that the sphenoid sinus, you have an optic nerve, and the anterior ethmoid, if they are pneumatized, or anterior clinal process, they are pneumatized, they give you a clue that probably you are having a striking optic nerve within the sinus. You have the foramen rotundum and Wiedian canal. lying medially here. And here on the axial scan, you are seeing the indentation of the carotids on either side. So sphenoid sinus bears very important relations with its lateral nasal wall. And a lot of time, if you have an isolate pathology in the sphenoid sinus, you can widen the opening of the sphenoid sinus using either a debrider, and then further you can widen it using the punch. But no power instrument should go within the sphenoid sinus because of the important relationship in the lateral nasal wall. While widening the sphenoid, you may come across the sphenopalatine ooze, and that can be handled using a monopolar cautery. That is only one place where you can use a monopolar cautery is here. Otherwise, rest all the places, very important to use a bipolar cautery so that there is no current transmitted to the surrounding region, because otherwise you can have direct entry and injury to the dura causing CSF leak. Here, this is a cadaver specimen where you can see the relation to the optic nerve. And here you're seeing the video where you can see that the carotid is dehiscent. And you can see the optic nerve, and this area of the carotid is dehiscent. Here was one of the case where the tumor was there. There was an erosion of the dura. Sorry. I don't know what happened with this video. Yeah, sorry. So here you can see that after the tumor was removed, you could see the dehiscent dura, you can see the dehiscent optic nerve, and you can also see the dehiscent siphon of the carotid. So when you are doing, you must know these relations, you must have studied the CT scan preoperatively, and you need to be very, very careful. This is the slide borrowed from Professor Kennedy, and you can see here that there is bilaterally the optic nerve is lying bare in the sphenoid sinus, almost like a kissing carotids in the sphenoid. But sometime you have carotid winking at you. This is a post-operative video where you can see that the pulsation of the carotid within the sphenoid sinus. And hence, it's very important that the post-operative care for the patient is taken by the same surgeon, because he's the one who knows the relations. So when we describe the mesoclingus technique, the first step is clear the anterior ethmoid cells, which are small and multiple, and then go towards the posterior ethmoid cell through the ground lamella and clear them, and go through the anterior face of the sphenoid to clear the sphenoid sinus. So here you can see that there are multiple numerous anterior ethmoid cells versus large and few posterior ethmoid cells. So when we are operating using the endoscope and doing the endoscopic sinus surgery, our middle turbinate is the main landmark. It serves like a lighthouse in the nasal cavity, telling you where to go and where not to go. I love to preserve the middle turbinate because it remains as a landmark for future surgeon, future pathology, if there is any recurrence. But at times you may have to trim the middle turbinate when you are doing advanced cases or basal surgeries. Then you must see that at times the stump of the middle turbinate may get lateralized and block the drainage from the frontal sinus. So as far as possible, try and preserve the middle turbinate. Here you can see that the middle turbinate is removed to just expose the site of the CSF leak. So in such scenario, you cannot prevent removal of the turbinate. But in cases where you have only isolated sphenoid disease, and here you are seeing that the anterior ethmoid, posterior ethmoid cells are very clear, then here you're seeing that it's an isolated sphenoid sinusitis, then you can do something called a Wigand's technique, where you remove the middle turbinate do not disturb the anterior and the posterior ethmoid cells and directly address the sphenoid sinus directly. And in this situation, you may need to remove the middle turbinate. Wigan technique is of very great help when you don't have any other landmark, because sphenoid is very easily identified using a coronal arch as a landmark. Coming to the frontal sinus, here you can see the frontal drainage, again a lateral nasal wall specimen where you can see the agar nasa has been opened up. And this is a very famous schematic diagram from Professor Stamberger's book, where you know that the frontal sinus, the narrowest area is the frontal ostium, which can be blocked or which can be obliterated or which can have, you, one can have difficulty in accessing it if there's a very large agar nasa cell, or if there is a large uncinate or upper part of the uncinate is obstructing, or if you have a very large bulla ethmoidalis, which is there posteriorly. So it can block the frontal nasal drainage area. So here you have two tiers of agar nasa cell, and they need to be removed before you want to approach the sphenoid sinus. Frontal sinus. There is also axillary flap technique, which is described by Professor Wallman, where he creates a flap at the level of the axilla and turns it medial to the middle turbinate, removes the agar nasa cell, and this helps accessing the frontal recess using a 0-degree telescope. So for the beginner, this can be a very good option when they are learning to use the angle telescope. And it's, if done properly, can create less raw area, but one needs to preserve the flap and reposit it nicely. Coming back to the uncinate process and its attachment, as we discussed already, that if the uncinate is removed well, it can give you an access to the maxillary and frontal sinus. Here you are seeing that there is a pathology on the right side, and the uncinate process on the right side is attached to the lamina papyracea, while for the same patient on the other side, it is attached to the middle turbinate. So here the frontal drainage is medial to the uncinate attachment. And while in the opposite side, where the uncinate process is attached to the middle turbinate, the drainage is going to be lateral to the uncinate process. So attachment of the uncinate process is extremely important to identify the frontal drainage pathway. And to repeat here, that if you remove the uncinate well, the lower part removal gives an access to the maxillary sinus, and if you remove the upper part well, it gives you an access to the frontal sinus. There is another technique which is popularized in our country by Professor Sethi, that you keep the bulla intact, which Dr. Ramandeep also showed you a beautiful video. And keeping the bulla intact, you can access the frontal sinus. The advantage being that you are not accessing the anterior ethmoidal artery, and hence you are relatively working in the bloodless area, and hence reaching the frontal sinus when you are fresh and there is no bleeding, it's easier to address the frontal ostium. Here you just see the frontal ostium being seen. And using the intact bulla technique, removing the upper part of the uncinate, you can get a good access towards the frontal ostium. At times you cannot do the intact bulla technique if you don't have much support. Bulla recess to operate onto, you have to get the bulla down. So one must know all the various techniques to approach and then decide as per the given situation and the CT scan findings. Coming to the anatomy of the base skull, you are seeing here the frontal bone. It gets attached to the ethmoid. Ethmoid is a very thin, flimsy bone, while frontal bone is a very sturdy bone, and they attach at this way, and the junction is further weakened by traversing anterior and the posterior ethmoidal artery. So if you are seeing the scan here, and if I see the bird's eye view of this area, you see that there is a lateral lamella, which is a part of the ethmoid bone, while the roof of the frontal is partly formed by the frontal bone, which is relatively thick. It's nearly 10 times thicker than the bone of ethmoid. So there is a discrepancy of the thickness of the roof here, and it's further, this area is further weakened by traversing anterior ethmoidal artery. So this becomes a very weak area for injury. And hence one needs to be very careful. You must see the depth of the olfactory groove, like Keros divided that into type 1, type 2, type 3. Here my animation has gone moved a little bit, but here the medial lamella and the lateral lamella, and the olfactory fossa is very, very shallow, the depth being 1 to 3 millimeter. In a type 2 Keros, you have the medial lamella and the lateral lamella. The height of lateral lamella is 4 to 7 millimeter. And in the Keros type 3, which is more vulnerable to injury, the height of the lateral lamella is 8 to 13 millimeter. So when you are operating in this region, one should not face the forceps towards the lateral lamella. Otherwise, this thin area, you can easily enter the cranial cavity and you can have a CSF leak. So one needs to be very, very careful. You should turn your forceps laterally when you are looking for the frontal ostium. Otherwise, this is one of the commonest complications, and this is the commonest site of CSF leak while looking for the frontal sinus. So if you get by accident, you open the or create the CSF leak, you should know how to close it, and you should... Here you can close it using the fat fascia and use a tissue glue to close this defect. Coming to the types of the frontal cells, you have type 1, depending upon the number of cells before you reach the frontal sinus. It's type 1 is here when you have a single cell in the frontal recess above the agonizae. When type 2, when the tire of stute cells in the frontal recess above agonizae. Type 3 is a single massive cell pneumatized cephalid into the frontal sinus. Here you can see that the cell is entering the frontal sinus partly, and when it is single isolated cell within the frontal sinus is a type 4 frontal cell. You must also remember that at times there could be agenesis of the frontal sinus, and this should be made note of before you do the surgery. At times, the frontal hematization can go far beyond the laterally, and it's very difficult to approach this region. Here you see that there is a septa here, and suppose if the mucus occurs in this, extremely difficult to reach this area. You may have to do a combined approach to reach that frontal sinus. Unusually, sometimes both the sides frontal may open into the one side. So one must remember all these variations can exist. So when you are doing the endoscopic sinus surgery, you have four lamella to face. The first and foremost is the uncinate process. The second lamella is the bulla ethmoidalis. Then comes the ground lamella. And last is the anterior face of the sphenoid. Now, as we all know, that if ethmoids were placed in any other part of the body, it would be an insignificant and harmless collection of bony cells. In the place where nature has put it, it has major relationships, so that the disease and surgery of the labyrinth often lead to tragedy. Any surgery in this region should be simple, but it has proven to be one of the easiest ways to kill a patient. And hence, we must know its relation. And that is why the surgery of the sinus is very vulnerable to complications. And one must study the lateral nasal wall very carefully and then embark on the surgery. Let me go to the folder of the complication. a lot of point on the complications I've already dealt when we were doing the steps and technique of endoscopic sinus surgery. I'll try and see that there are not much repetitions so that we have some time left for discussion. The complication can occur because of anesthesia. Just giving a simple infiltration can cause a temporary ophthalmoplegia. This infiltration can go to orbital apex, and there are reported cases of even blindness following the infiltration. You can have intraoperative complications and postoperative complications. The preoperative workup remains the most important thing for preventing the complications, because as Dr. Ramandeep already said, the maximal medical line of treatment, if done prior to the surgery, then the field of the surgery is very good. The preparation of the patient is good, then the bleeding is less, and one can see the landmarks very well, and surgery goes smooth. It also controls the infection, and thereby one can really do the meticulous surgery without much of bleeding. Otherwise, in presence of bleeding, the meticulous surgery cannot be performed because there are multiple instrumentation occurs. You are repeatedly doing the suction, and it creates more and more raw area. Using a powered instrument also gives you a mucosal blanket and gives a good intraoperative meticulous surgery. Before doing the surgery, one must take a detailed history. One must know that if there are no contraindications for surgery, patient is not on any anticoagulant, patient is not taking excessive amount of aspirin, because all that works towards the preparation of the patient. One must do a detailed clinical examination, should do a diagnostic endoscopy to see and assess the area of nasal cavity, to assess the narrowest area and whether there's a need of correcting the septum or not, and to see whether the preparation, pre-op preparation is done well or not. And the most important is CT scan. Now one must do a CT scan, the coronal, axial, as well as sagittal scan to know the anatomy of the frontal recess well. So the time of doing only limited CT scan has moved towards the full-blown CT scan of the paranasal sinuses, because that is also important, because if you have an access to navigation system, then you must feed the scans into the navigation system, so for which you have to do a full CT scan of the paranasal sinuses. One must study the preoperatively, the variations and the anatomical landmarks and the pathophysiology well, because that is where you will identify whether there is a ONOD cell or not, whether there is a day sense or not, and what are the important things to be looked into. One must go through the checklist before doing the surgery. That helps you in patient selection. Thorough patient preparation should be done. We always like to give sufficient time after the putting nasal patty, or nowadays we prefer to use Merosil cut into pieces and threaded so that you don't forget that in the nasal cavity, but you do concentrated solution of the lignocaine with adrenaline can be used to prepare the patient. Meticulous surgery prevents a lot of complications intraoperative as well as postoperatively, and a good postoperative care is also necessary as much as it is important to a meticulous surgery. We already talked about the orbital fat prolapse, that one must take care that the powered instruments do not come in close contact with that. You should not try to remove the orbital fat, because the more try to remove or repose it, the more it comes out. So just keep it untouched and carry on the rest of the surgery. Now, bleeding is one of the most disturbing complications intraoperatively. It can occur from the anterior ethmoidal artery, or it can occur from the posterior ethmoidal artery. We already saw this video, and the most important instrument to be used in this is a bipolar cautery. If you have it with suction, it's very good. You can also have bleeding from sphenopalatine artery or the posterior septal branch, and one must use packing And bipolar cautery with suction gives you an added advantage. Especially when you are doing more of the tumors, you must have a suction bipolar cautery. Very rarely the artery may retract. If both the ends are not cauterized well and it's dehiscent, then artery can get retracted and can cause intraorbital bleeding and can cause orbital hematoma resulting into the proptosis. This require and can cause diminished vision if it is causes retroorbital hematoma pressing onto the optic nerve. So one must assess the vision and acuity of field. One must assess the site and size of the hematoma. And if it is periorbital, easy to manage. Intraorbital and retrobulbar are more dangerous, can press on the optic nerve. What one must do is a gentle eye massage one should do, and diuretics to be given. And what is mannitol has a little doubtful role. If you are buying a time and arranging for theater, one can do a lateral canthotomy because it gives you an additional time to prepare for the theater. But the main treatment remains the orbital decompression. I'll try and show you this with the more pictorial animation. Here, when you are doing the anterior ethmoidectomy, you may accidentally enter the orbit, and if the bleeding occurs within the orbit, there is a on table proptosis occurs. One must do gentle massage and remove the pack so that the whatever is blood collected into the nasal orbital cavity can be removed, and this hematoma is not allowed to get organized. So some of the blood may come out, and then one can do a orbital decompression by deliberately removing the lamina papyracea. Here they are completing the posterior ethmoidectomy, sphenoidectomy, and then remove the lamina papyracea deliberately and allow this hematoma to drain into the nasal cavity. So it can be dealt immediately if there is such situation occurs, and if you are not well versed with everything, there no harm taking help of some senior colleagues. Here is one of my patients who developed the orbital hematoma. Incidentally, this patient was, surgery was done under local anesthesia. This patient already was a faculty member's father. Surgery was postponed twice because of the high blood pressure. And when the surgery was done under local anesthesia, I ended up with something like this. So first and foremost, one person has to do is to remove the pack and do a gentle massage and allow that hematoma to come out. Yes, madam.
You are playing the video?
No, there is no video in this. The previous had a video.
Okay, then. None of the videos are playing.
No, we are madam, not.
We are not seeing anything.
Yeah, we are seeing just the fragmented thing. You need to get onto the screen share again.
I'm on the screen share.
No.
Open your PPT.
No.
Just click on that avoiding complications face, that presentation.
One sec.
Double click on that.
Sorry. Share. Yeah. You did not get to see the previous proptosis and all that?
No, nothing, madam.
Then you should tell me. Because it was playing on my computer.
No, I was thinking it was not playing for me. Then now I checked it. They said it's not seen. So again, I called you. Yeah.
Anyway, now my presentation is not moving. Sorry, shall I do stop share and do it again? Okay, share screen.
Yes.
Now we can see the slides.
Give me a moment. Now can you see the animation?
Yeah, these are all we can, yeah.
No, again, it's going back to the same thing. Yes. Can you see the screen now?
Yeah, now we can
see. So when you are doing the endoscopic sinus surgery, if you accidentally enter the orbit and if you have an orbital hematoma, you will have on-table proptosis. So what one should do is to massage the eye and allow that collected blood to come out of the orbit into the nasal cavity. The gentle massage also prevents hematoma from being formed, and one can complete the surgery. Here you can see the prostate mud cell being removed. And one can deliberately remove the lamina papyracea and allow this hematoma to drain. I hope you can see now. Hello?
Yes, we can see. Very well.
So here was one of our patients who had an orbital hematoma. The first and foremost thing, if you land up with this, is to remove the nasal pack and do the gentle massage of the eye and allow the blood to flow. And this is the patient after 2 days. So if you act on time, you can save the vision. Here, there was no need of orbital decompression, because patient already had a preoperative opening into the lamina papyracea, and there was a suspicion of the tumor, and hence this patient was operated under local anesthesia, being a being hypertensive. Just a biopsy was taken and patient ended up with the hematoma. So one must not do any shortcut in preoperative preparation. The blood pressure must be controlled, and then only you must venture. Whenever you are doing a surgery and your field is very bloody, it is wise to stop, go another day and do the surgery. Because when there was a study done on the complications, there was one thing in common, that the surgery was done under general anesthesia and vision was not good. There was excessive bleeding. So rather than continuing with the surgery in a field which is not favorable and landing up with the complication, it is better to stop. It is better to be very frank to the patient that since there was a lot of oozing, we have not completed the surgery, and it's better to go second time and do the surgery when the field is good. As I already told you, middle turbinate serves as a landmark, and one must maintain the integrity of the axillary arch. Otherwise, if there is a raw area created, you can have the lateralization of the, it is going by itself. Sorry. Coming to the slide, that there is a maxilla here and the lacrimal bone. So you can see that how closely the lacrimal bone is attached. And nasolacrimal duct traverses through this nasal canal. So if you widen the maxillary ostium beyond the bony butt, it's very easy to damage the nasolacrimal duct, and you can get the decreocystitis. Here is the exposed nasolacrimal duct. Very rarely you see epiphora because it's usually self-limiting, but one must not widen the maxillary ostium beyond the bony part. Also, there is a theory of nitrous oxide. So excessive widening of the maxillary ostium is not good. One can get diplopia if there's an injury to the medial rectus muscle. It could be transient or it could be persistent. This was one of our patients with orbital cellulitis, and doing the orbital decompression, patient had a medial rectus palsy. When we did the post-operative scan, we realized that the medial rectus was pulled medially because of the fat prolapse. And when we discussed this with our ophthalmologist, they said that removing this fat can allow the muscle to go back. And this was done at the later stage, and patient regained the medial rectus palsy. If you enter the lamina papyracea accidentally, you can have a minor orbital emphysema, which is usually self-limiting. The only precaution to be taken that post-operatively, patient should be told not to blow the nose. CSF rhinorrhea can occur either at the level of the cribriform plate or from the roof of ethmoid. We already discussed, but it is presented as a washout sign, and one must not get worried, but close the CSF leak then and then. To avoid the CSF leak, one must stay below the attachment of the middle turbinate, identify the roof of ethmoid, and turn inferomedially when you are going to the posterior ethmoid and sphenoid sinus. Avoid undue force while plucking the tissue. Blindness also, we discussed that damage to the optic nerve can cause blindness, and one must be very careful about the landmarks on OD cell situation, and one must not work in the sphenoid sinus using any power instruments. It can also occur because of the damage to the intraorbital content and retroorbital hematoma. Coming to the major complications, the injury to cavernous sinus can occur, but if there is only puncture, then you can use it using a gel foam, Surgicel, Surgiflow, Flocil, and one has to be very gentle. You cannot use a lot of pressure on the cavernous sinus, because we have had one of the incidents where we had a keratico-cavernous shunt because of the tight packing. So one needs to pack it, but be gentle. Patience and prayer does help in this time. Injury to major vessels can occur. Like here, one of the patients where we were taking a biopsy, skull-based tumor, where while taking the biopsy, there was an internal carotid injury on the, and the interventional radiologist come to our rescue, and you can see the pseudo aneurysm here. The balloon occlusion test was done and seen that the opposite carotid had a very good collaterals, and the that side carotid was coiled, and we could save the patient. Rare complications during the routine endoscopic sinus surgery, these are rare, but as the advances occur, more and more advanced cases are being done. Most of the skull-based surgeries, one must are more prone to injury to carotids, injury to cavernous sinus, anterior cranial fossa injury could occur, there could be intrapneumocephalus, and the anesthetic complication could be in the forms of hypotension and arrhythmias. So coming to the tips for the novice endoscopists, that one must know the anatomy and anatomical variations well, one must know the pathophysiology well, one must do cadaver dissection, one must observe and assist the endoscopic sinus surgery and begin with diagnostic endoscopy, learn the instrumentation on while doing the postoperative care, evaluate and learn to see the CT scan of paranasal sinuses. Initially, one should start with the minor surgical procedure and then go into the advanced cases. Start with virgin cases, and revisions are kept for the experienced colleagues. And one must begin to operate under supervision. And while, no, this is a repetition. One must stay below the attachment of the middle turbinate and while entering the sphenoid, one must turn inferomedially. You must have all your instrumentation parallel to your telescope, and at no time you want your instrument going into the cranial cavity, and for which one must study the lateral wall anatomy well. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the patient hearing. And I can answer if there are any questions or if there's any time left for questions.
Thank you, Dr. Hetal ma'am. Everybody enjoyed both the lectures as well as the technique and complications. There are some few questions. Can I carry the questions, Madam Bharti?
Yeah. Continue.
I take some questions in the time frame. So yeah. There are some questions about the indications. First question is Dr. Kripomai Nath from Silchar. What is the indications for FAS in children, Dr. Hetal?
Oh, there is a wide variety of indications for FAS in children, because same application is being applied to the children. But what one tends to do is to do a very minimally invasive surgery. Like for maxillary sinusitis, you can just do a Parsons window, remove the part of the uncinate at the junction of the vertical and the horizontal part, and just do an anti-ethmoid clearance. That will revert most of the sinusitis. We have done a lot of surgeries on pediatric. We have probably a largest series in the pediatric endoscopic sinus surgery. You could come across the encephalocele, which are, and the first and foremost, choanal atresias can be done endoscopically. The only thing is that the space to operate is less. We prefer to miniaturize the instrument versus the miniaturizing the endoscope. So we have the entire publication on to using the micro ear instrument for doing pediatric endoscopic sinus surgery. So there are all the indications can be referred to for the pediatric age group too, but the meticulous surgery and is needed.
So, in short, we can say that we have to be a little conservative rather than going much radical. So, yes. That is the message, I think, Dr. Hetal. Now, there is some questions about how to manage medial rectal muscle injury by Dr. Subramaniam from the Chennai. Medial rectus muscle injury.
It depends upon whether how, what kind of injury it is. Like in our case, which we showed, it was medial rectus muscle was just pulled medially because of the fat prolapse. But if the powered instrument has done a damage, then it cannot be reverted. Or if the muscle is actually cut end to end, then you require an oculoplastic surgeon to do a sling surgery and repair it, because the two ends should be identified and then can be sutured. But then the recovery is questionable. So it depends upon if there is a if there is just a injury or there is a transection of the muscle. It depends upon that. But oculoplastic surgery can be done, and they do some sling surgeries to correct the medial rectus palsy.
True, Dr. Hetal. It's a really grave things to injure the medial rectus muscle. It is very difficult to repair.
There are reported cases in the literature.
So now the next question is about the best landmark to identify the frontal recess in FAS.
There is not one single landmark for FAS, because you have to be knowing all the landmarks, because what is the anatomical situation, it depends on that. But safely, one can do intact bulla technique so that you don't have bleeding coming in your view. When you start the surgery after doing your uncinectomy, remove the upper part of the uncinate very well. And then keeping the bulla intact, if you take the 45-degree telescope when you're beginning with it, because ideal is 70 degree, but it's very difficult to get used to 70 degree telescope. So either one can start with 30 degree and then gradually go on to 45 degree and then go into the 70 degree, because it is like driving the car with just side mirrors.
So
one has to get used to it.
So best method is to go for intake bullet technique. I think that is the most safe
and
one.
Stay lateral to the middle turbinate.
Yeah.
All forceps directing laterally and not towards the lateral lamella.
So, Dr. Srinivasan, you also have some questions for Dr. Raman.
Yes,
before
sir.
That, I take 2-3 questions. One question is, how can we prevent the bleeding from the posterior septal branch of the sphenopalatine artery when we are doing sphenoid ostia widening?
The posterior septal artery is very notorious. It has got very multiple branches. So they tend to bleed because they are towards the lower part of the ostium.
Yes.
And towards the coronal arch. So one may need to use a bipolar cautery or at times bipolar cautery at multiple places to take care of the bleeding from the posterior septal artery. But if you are doing a skull based surgery, then once you fire the posterior septal artery, you cannot harvest the flap for reconstruction.
So it is a very nice, excellent presentation. Everybody has appreciated. And one, the last question is, what is ethmoidal terminal concept?
Sorry?
Ethmoidal terminal concept.
Yeah.
I really don't know about it.
Okay.
Because it is so controversial that whether to consider that as a principle or not is a questionable thing.
Right. So, Dr. Srinivasan?
Yes, sir. I'm here.
Take over.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Dr. Raman?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Couple of questions and then we will wind up, I guess.
Right.
We have one question from Ramasubramaniam.
Right.
From Chennai. Why not use oral antifungal drugs for fungal sinusitis?
Yes. So in the key action statements of the American Academy and the EPOS paper, the question was raised that why do we want to use an antifungal drug? What extra will it do? Okay. The things it will cause are more side effects. That means toxicity. It is more expensive. Right. And
yes.
It gives no added benefit of adding a antifungal agent.
Okay.
So in the rhinosinusitis guidelines, it is a strict no-no that no kind of antifungal therapy for chronic rhinosinusitis is to be given. In fact, it is a recommendation against therapy based on systemic review of RCTs with a preponderance of benefit over harm for not treating. So if you don't give, it is actually a benefit. But if you give, you can actually, there is a preponderance of harm over benefit.
Okay. Dr. Muneeshwara from Tumkur, management of allergic rhinitis in pregnancy.
I mean, we routinely give steroid nasal sprays. Because the reason for that is the absorption is very, very minimal. The bioavailability is very less.
Yeah. So, could you come again, sir?
We would routinely use a steroid nasal spray.
Okay.
Allergic rhinitis. And right. Many times during pregnancy, what we see as allergic rhinitis is also the edema that has occurred, the nasal blockage because of the congestion due to pregnancy.
Yeah. So mostly a kind of emotional kind of
Exactly, and hormonal imbalance.
Hormonal imbalance, and commonly, generally seen in the second trimester, beginning of the second trimester.
And a lot of patients will come, I'm having a nasal block. You look in bilateral inferior turbinate hypertrophy, you tell the patient it's going to go away, put in a lot of saline, it'll give some systematic relief. By the time their trimester will be over, or the patient is in third trimester, give them a steroid nasal spray. It's not going to do any harm in that age. And anyways, intranasal corticosteroids have been proven in all studies long term that they don't cause any ophthalmic, besides epistaxis, headache, and itching. They don't have any systemic cortisol level increase. They don't cause lens opacity. They don't cause elevated intraocular pressure or any other ocular symptoms.
Okay. More of counseling and telling them that nothing's going to happen. It's quite physiological, and probably little saline would be more reassuring to them.
Right.
We'll have one last question.
Many times the patient, if you tell them I'm giving you a steroid, in patients, steroids.
They hyperreact.
Hyperreact के पता नहीं डॉक्टर साहब पॉइजन दे रहे हैं डॉक्टर साहब उससे तो सब खराब हो जाता है but you have to tell them the dose is such the delivery system is such that there is nothing to worry and we give it to little kids also so you don't have anything to worry.
Okay, we'll have one last question from Dr. Kripamoy Nath Silchar. How SNOT 22 helps in evaluating symptoms?
The SNOT 22 test, right? Sinus nasal outcome test. It is a predictor of improvement post surgery. Basically, it tells you quality of life issues. It is based on that. SNOT 22 is one. It used to be SNOT 20 in the past, and there are a couple of other things which you can ask the patient. Especially many patients will complain of anosmia or hyposmia, and when that's happening, they can't taste food. So quality of life in sinus disease definitely is affected. So these SNOT tests, SNOT 22, are more for our publication work or to have something objective to compare rather than just
for proving it statistically.
Yes, rather than just the patient saying haan ji I am better. So how do you write it that the patient saying I am better? So post nasal drip, pain, pressure, there are tons of things
So basically to indicate the quality of life index.
Quality of life, yes, basically for quality of life.
Dr. Bharti madam. Do we have time or we can finish?
No, you have any questions or we can finish?
We have a couple of questions, both from Dr. Bharat sir as well as from my side. My side almost done.
Okay, yeah. Then.
Yeah.
Yeah. On behalf of from the AOI, I thank our speakers today who are very good. Raman. Extremely good and lucid talk. You covered everything. Such an exhaustive topic in 1 hour. And really, we enjoyed your talk. And Dr. Hetal was very good. And we liked all those videos. And, she highlighted those tips. That was very nice. Yeah, the CT scans and then the complications. These two things play a major role. And your checklist, how to prepare, and all this play a major role in defining a good functional endoscopic sinus surgery and how to avoid complications. And I thank our moderators, Dr. Srinivas and Dr. Bharat Kakkad, for taking their time out in this COVID era. And we have done a good day today. I thank everyone. We'll end the show today. Thanks.
Thank you, madam.
I thank the Reddy's Lab for their cooperation.
Thank you.
Bye, Vipulish. Good night, everyone.
Good night. Thank you very much.
Bye.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Vimlesh.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. Thanks to Dr. Samir, Dr. Kaushal, the rest of the team for having this wonderful program today. I will give you a feedback about the postgraduates, how they have taken the program.
Yeah. Thanks a lot, sir.
Vimlesh.
Thank you, madam.
Yeah.
Thank you, madam.